Hello and welcome to Science Monitor, a show that brings to you the most significant news from the world of science, technology, innovation, research, discoveries, and much more. I'm Ashwarya Kapoor, and here are this week's headlines. Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India, Professor K. Vijay Raghvan, announces details of 9 science and technology missions with focus on science for people and people for science. In an exclusive interview, we speak to Dr. Renu Swaroop, a Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, on the role of biotechnology and the contribution of a women scientist. Researchers at Aranya Foundation in Odisha for the first time identify and document new breeding grounds of the Black Bellied Tern. Department of Science and Technology presents a women entrepreneurs a grant of 25 lakh for their business ideas in scientific arenas. Science and technology are key aspects for the government to effect a social and economic change. For this, scientists and society must connect and build stronger foundations for education, fundamental research, and applications in agriculture, health, environment, and energy. Towards this, a principal scientific advisor to the Government of India, Professor K. Vijay Raghvan, shared details about 9 science and technology missions with a focus on science for people and people for science, which was also the theme for this year's Science Day. Science Monitor brings you this report.
Indian scientists have been striving to move forward and take India with great stride to new heights. The government has been putting together all its sources to achieve this dream. In this direction, Principal Scientific Advisor Professor K. Vijay Raghavan announced 9 science and technology missions. The mission aims to understand and conserve our biodiversity and develop sustainable agricultural processes, precision health for personal well-being, recover wealth from waste, develop and use artificial intelligence, connected mobility solutions, and other technologies. Its main objective is to address frontier scientific questions and challenges, thereby enabling sustainable development for India. These missions focus on the concept of science for people and people for science.
People from science and technology in the academic sector, those who are dealing with applications, and those who are dealing with industry. And the idea is to combine all of this to have a group of people who do 2 things. One is look at the entire complexity of our science and technology landscape and see how the major challenges which the country faces can be addressed by us working together.
9 national missions announced includes natural language translation. It is planned to set up an ecosystem which involves central and state government agencies and startups who will work with scientists and build implementable solutions. Quantum Frontier. This mission aims to initiate work in control of the quantum mechanical systems. Quantum mechanics is a theory of the mechanics of atoms, molecules, and other physical systems that are subject to the uncertainty principle. Building excellence in the quantum frontier through this mission will also be essential for national security and in the development of quantum computers, quantum chemistry, quantum communications, new materials, quantum sensors, and quantum cryptography. Artificial intelligence. This mission will work with extensive academia-industry interactions on developing co-research capability of national level, which will include international collaborations. National Biodiversity Mission. This mission will include a comprehensive documentation of India's biodiversity with the potential of cataloging and mapping all life forms in India, including associated cultural and traditional practices. Electric Vehicles. This mission is critical for India to reduce fossil fuel consumption and mitigate emissions. Electric vehicles are a major component of India's mobility plans. Bioscience for Human Health. This mission will focus on the genomic study of populations of humans to identify and unravel the genetic basis and prevalence of rare and inherited diseases. Waste to Wealth. This mission will assist and augment the Swachh Bharat and Smart Cities project by using science, technology and innovation. Deep ocean exploration. This mission will scientifically explore the deep oceans towards improving our understanding of the blue frontier. The information from this mission will address issues arising from long-term challenges in the ocean due to climate change. Mission Agni. Accelerating growth for New India's innovation, taking technologies to commercialization. This mission includes services across the techno-commercialization chain required to support and upscale market-ready indigenous innovations. Each innovation will be governed by a ministry in collaboration with international and national institutes, scientists and industry. Other important projects under the council includes research clusters, Earth Museum, Brahmaputra River System and iSTEM, Indian Science Technology and Engineering Facilities Map. These new and exciting developments will help to enable future preparedness in emerging domains of science and technology.
The Department of Biotechnology under the Ministry of Science and Technology plays a significant role in facilitating frontier research in the sector of biotechnology and biosciences. Last month, the department marked its 33rd Foundation Day. In an exclusive interview with Science Monitor, Dr. Renu Swaroop, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, talks about the department's mandate, role of a woman in science, and how biotechnology contributes to society and the environment at large.
Biotechnology offers innumerable benefits in various spheres of life. Since the past few decades, this field of science has played a significant role in changing the lives of people all around. In India, the Department of Biotechnology under the Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, is the premier governing body of this sector. The department promotes research and development in diverse areas of biotechnology under the supervision of Dr. Renu Swaroop, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology. Over the years, the department has envisaged research and development in the areas of medical, agriculture, animal, environment, energy, human genetics and much more. Through its several schemes and programs, DBT targets demographics of every part of the country involved in scientific research. In an exclusive interview, Dr. Renu Swaroop shares her 29 years of experience in DBT along with the various schemes and programs of the department for the empowerment of women in science.
Ma'am, you have spent 30 years in the Department of Biotechnology. So how has been your journey so far?
I think this has been one of the most exciting journeys that I've had. I started as a junior scientist and DBT has given me wonderful opportunities to come up to where I am. And I think this is the best that someone can hope for, is to be able to lead a department with which you've been so closely associated.
What were the challenges that you faced while being the secretary of the department?
A challenge is always an opportunity to be able to find a solution to do something much better. And the reason why I say I find my whole journey in DBT interesting is at each step we found challenges. We found challenges which were not hurdles, but we found challenges which actually gave you an opportunity to address a much larger issue, look at solutions which could address that. And that keeps you on your toes, that keeps you looking for new initiatives. And I think that's really what has been the fuel for this whole journey that I've had so far.
Please tell us about some of the schemes and programs for women in science that DBT offers.
DBT, since its inception, has had some wonderful initiatives that we've done, both for women in science and also science for women. Both aspects we cover. So coming to the women in science, our major initiative is the BioCare scheme. We also, as I said, do a lot of initiatives for how science benefits women. Those programs, be it women and child health, be it nutrition, be it looking at their livelihood activities, each one of them we focused in great detail.
Ma'am, could you please elaborate on DBT's National Biotechnology Development Strategy Program?
The focus is on research, on education, on entrepreneurship. So that we look at the entire biotech ecosystem. And there are broadly three major pillars that we focus on. One is the capacity building, in which we do a lot in terms of human resource, infrastructure. The second vertical is, of course, the main research, deep science, discovery, basic research, new areas, cutting edge science. The third major vertical is our translational ecosystem, connecting the research from the laboratory to the user.
Recently, during the 33rd session of the Foundation Day of DBT, Atal Jai Anusandhan Mission was launched. So, what was it all about?
Atal Jai Anusandhan Mission that we've launched, which is Unnati, and Unnati is an acronym for Undertaking Nationally Relevant Technology Innovations. So it's an acronym actually. It brings in five programs under its purview.
Right.
And all five of them are related to societal benefit, to addressing the societal needs. And they are health, agriculture and nutrition, and clean energy and environment.
How biotechnology has helped in making the lives of people better?
I think biotechnology is such a unique area because it's not any one technology.
Right.
It's a combination of all the cutting edge tools and technologies which look at the biosystem. In fact, the whole bioeconomy agenda for the country is driven with biotechnology. We have seen wonderful solutions today, be it in the healthcare, be it our rotavirus vaccine that we brought out, be it the 12 new varieties that we have brought out for different crops of rice, wheat, maize, which have really enhanced the farmers' livelihoods, be it, as I said, the biofuels that we've looked at, or our animal husbandry areas, cattle genomics, each field, if you talk about diagnostics, which have now been becoming a part for the Ayushman Bharat. I think biotechnology has touched every aspect of our human life.
Thank you so much for talking with us, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
It's time for a short break, and when we return, we will take you to Odisha, where researchers have documented new breeding grounds of the Black Bellied Tern. But that's after a short break. Keep watching Science Monitor. Mahanadi River in Odisha is an abode for several bird species of India, including the black-bellied tern, which is listed as endangered by International Union of Conservation of Nature. The Mahanadi riverine ecosystem, where the tern breeds, is under threat due to increasing human interference from diverse factors like construction of dams, sand mining, and year-round fishing. This year, researchers of the Aranya Foundation have, for the first time, identified and documented new breeding grounds of the black-bellied tern and documented the threats these endangered birds face. This study is the first step to help protect this endangered bird's ecosystem in the Mahanadi River catchment areas. Science Monitor brings you this special report from Odisha.
Birds are unique gifts of nature. In addition to being beautiful creatures, they play vital roles in sustaining life on Earth. In the present day scenario, however, several bird species are facing an imminent threat to their existence due to pollution, deforestation, rampant construction, and vast urbanization. It is estimated that around 161 bird species have gone extinct since 1500. To save black-bellied tern bird of India, a group of researchers from Aranya Foundation in Odisha has for the first time documented breeding grounds for these birds along Mahanadi River at three locations and identified potential threats to their existence and come up with possible solutions to conserve them in the state. It is named black-bellied because its belly region turns black in the breeding plumage. Its population is declining worldwide due to construction of dams, damage to riverine ecosystems, overharvesting in wetlands, and extraction of sand and gravel. It is presumed to be locally extinct in Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, and Vietnam, and is listed as endangered by International Union of Conservation of Nature, which is the global authority on the status of natural world and measures needed to safeguard it. In India, the black-bellied tern is widely distributed in large rivers throughout the country. This year, in an important report published in the Journal of Threatened Taxa, researchers have documented three locations, Mundali, Kakhadi, and Jatamundia in Mahanadi riverbed, that are breeding grounds of the black-bellied tern. They face three threats to their existence. First, being sand mining and fishing near breeding sites, The second threat is regular flooding in Mahanadi, since sandy islands along Mahanadi are highly prone to flooding. In addition, grazing buffaloes on nesting islands contribute to destroying nests and trampling eggs and chicks.
During earlier times, say about 30-40 years ago, black bellied terns were very commonly found throughout South Asian countries. But since the last few decades, like say about 1 or 2 decades, these species have been gone locally extinct in many of the South Asian countries. Now it is only confined to some countries like India, Pakistan, Nepal and parts of Myanmar. So for the conservation, I think there should be a collaboration between the forest department, between the revenue department, between the water resource department, so that they can jointly plan something for conservation of the species. And major threat is none of the breeding sites in Odisha come within any protected area. So as it is not coming under any protected area, so there is no law and order activities.
Now that researchers have identified threats that black-bellied tern face in Odisha, they aim to conserve these birds for long term by protecting their nesting area along the Mahanadi. The first step of conservation is spreading awareness among local communities to minimize human disturbance in the area. They also suggest that with help from officials of forest, irrigation and revenue department, conserving black-bellied tern for long term is possible. Researchers also plan to conduct regular surveys along the entire stretch of Mahanadi to understand status of bird population and breeding over years.
Society for Innovation and Entrepreneurship at Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, in collaboration with the Women Entrepreneurship and Empowerment, or WE Foundation, celebrated International Women's Day on 9th of March in Mumbai. Here, 25 women entrepreneurs from different parts of the country presented their business ideas in the field of waste management, biotechnology, nanotechnology, robotics, and artificial intelligence. Selected few women entrepreneurs were awarded a grant of 25 lakh rupees from the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, for setting and scaling up their proposed ideas. Science Monitor brings you a report.
Over the years, women have carved their niche in research, development and innovating new products. Startups and new businesses run by women in this direction are gaining momentum. Recently, the Society of Innovation and Entrepreneurship, or SIGN, based at Indian Institute of Technology, Mumbai, in collaboration with Women Entrepreneurship and Empowerment Foundation, organized an event to promote entrepreneurship skills and to empower women. The event was organized on the occasion of the International Women's Day. The theme for the event was Women Economic Empowerment. The event focused on the role of women entrepreneurship in various fields including science and technology.
We are India's first of its kind initiative to strengthen women ecosystems, supported by IIT Delhi, Department of Science and Technology, Government of India and Niti Aayog. We strongly believe that the next revolution is going to come from women. But they need some support, they need some form of mentoring, and that's how we came up with the WE Foundation. It's a journey from me to WE Foundation.
During the event, around 25 women entrepreneurs from different parts of the country, from areas like waste management, biotechnology, nanotechnology, robotics and artificial intelligence, presented their business ideas. Women entrepreneurs were mentored for about 6 months at SIGN IIT Bombay. WE Mentorship is a program where a batch of 30 women is trained in entrepreneurship every 6 months. The mentorship session conducted business model validation, value proposition, identifying and solving problems, setting and scaling of business and funding. For their ideas, the jury awarded them a grant of Rs. 25 lakh from the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. One such idea by women entrepreneurs included making India water secure for generations to come. The proposal was made by Lata Ashok Jha of Greenosonic Foundation. The aim of the mission will be to provide innovative and cost-effective solutions to increase underground water table. The event also organized various panel discussions, and one such was on the women empowerment policies and practical applications. This one-of-a-kind initiative is a boost to promote women entrepreneurship in the field of science and technology. It also gives them a platform to showcase their leadership skills in the business front.
It's time for another short break, and when we come back, we will bring you some more news on science and innovation from India and around the world. Keep watching Science Monitor. Welcome back after the break. Let's now take a look at some more scientific innovations from India and across the globe.
A memorandum of understanding was recently signed between the Department of Science and Technology under the Government of India with the World Bank to strengthen the African Center of Excellence, or ACE, in Western, Eastern and Southern Africa. The MOU supports capacity building through knowledge transfer of students enrolled in ACE's master's and PhD programs. For this initiative, Indian Institute of Technology Roorkee will coordinate for collaborations of Indian institutes with various African Center of Excellence. Scientists have observed water molecules moving around the day side of the moon. They used data from NASA's Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. Measurements from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter helped to categorize lunar hydration changes over the course of a day. The study was published in the journal Geophysical Research Letters. These results will help in understanding the lunar water cycle and will ultimately help to learn about accessibility of water that can be used by humans in future missions to the moon. The test capsule sent by SpaceX to the International Space Station last week has successfully splashed down in the Atlantic Ocean. After more than 6 days in space and completing its demonstration mission for US space agency NASA. It was launched last week from Kennedy Space Center in Florida on a mission to demonstrate that it could carry astronauts to the International Space Station. Dragon docked at the station the following day before detaching early on 8th March for its return to Earth. A recent study suggests that the Milky Way weighs in at about 1.5 trillion solar masses. Solar mass is the mass of the Sun used as a unit of mass. Earlier research dating back several decades used a variety of observational techniques that provided estimates for our galaxy's mass ranging between 500 billion to 3 trillion solar masses. The improved measurements is near the middle of this range. Scientists at European Southern Observatory in Germany, Space Telescope Science Institute and Johns Hopkins University Center for Astrophysical Sciences in Maryland and University of Cambridge in United Kingdom say that the whole Milky Way cannot be put on a scale, but astronomers have been able to come up with one of the most accurate measurements yet of our galaxy's mass using NASA's Hubble Space Telescope and the European Space Agency's Gaia Telescope.
And in the history of science, this week we remember renowned scientist Joseph Priestley. He was one of the most prominent scientists of the 17th century. His research work focused on the study of nature and the properties of gases. Joseph Priestley is popularly known for the discovery of oxygen. For this, he examined air released from different substances. After successfully isolating the gas, he named it as a dephlogisticated air. This discovery by him contributed to a better understanding of processes like photosynthesis and respiration. In his entire career, he published about 150 research works. He died on 6th of February 1804 in Pennsylvania. In his memory, the Priestley Medal is awarded annually by the American Chemical Society. It is hard to overstate the importance of Priestley's revelation. Scientists now recognize 92 naturally occurring elements, including nitrogen and oxygen, the main components of air. Well, that is all for this episode of Science Monitor. You can send your feedback and suggestions to Science Monitor on our email ID news@vigyanprasad.gov.in. You can also write in to us at Vigyan Prasar, C24, Kutub Institutional Area, New Delhi 110016. We'll see you again next week with another episode of Science News and Innovations. Till then, goodbye and take care.